Okay, so we've already talked about what we're going to measure the inequality of, and we're going to concentrate on measuring income inequality. And how do we measure income inequality? And that last word there is supposed to be inequality, but it got kind of smushed. So the most common way in which people begin approaching this is they look at the overall population and they sort of go, okay, let's go ahead and think about the population falling into different chunks. And we have the lowest one-fifth, and sometimes this is done with tenths instead of fifths, but one-fifth is usually the sort of most common increment. The second lowest one-fifth, the middle one-fifth, the second highest one-fifth, and the top one-fifth. And then sometimes we sort of split this up into, you know, the top 5%, which would be the top 1/20th, or the top 1%, or so on and so forth here. And people go, okay, what is the average income of people in the lowest one-fifth, or what percent of income is earned by people in the lowest one-fifth? So we might go, okay, the average income of people in the lowest one-fifth is, say, here. The average income of people in the second highest, or second lowest one-fifth is right there, and here, and here, and this one's, like, way up here. Okay, so first we just start looking at some of the data, and then sometimes people go, all right, let's look at the ratio, say, for instance, of incomes in the highest one-fifth relative to incomes in the lowest one-fifth. So this is looking at the ratio of income between, these are, I believe, quintiles, so they're fifths. Okay. So that's one of the common measures out there. The other is often what percentage of income, of total national income, goes to each quintile. And if the income distribution were just completely flat, each fifth of the population would earn 20% of national income if it was completely proportional. But we might say, for instance, go, okay, maybe the lowest one-fifth earn 5%, and the next one earns 10%, and this is, say, 15%, and this is, say, 25%, and then sort of 40 plus 15, that would be 45%, I think, if I've done my math right. So, in that case, the ratio of the income quintiles would be, say, for instance, the ratio between the top and the bottom fifth would be 9 to 1. Okay, so that's one way people do it. Or sometimes they sort of go, all right, let's, so that sort of emphasizes the level of inequality between the very lowest and the very richest. Sometimes people sort of go, well, let's worry about inequality between people in the middle and people at the top and so on and so forth, in which case they'd be looking at the ratio between the income at the top percent and the income at the middle percent, and we'd get 3 to 1, say, for instance. So that's one way that people look at it. Another common way, sort of a one single number summary, is what's called the Gini coefficient. And actually, calculating the Gini coefficient is a little bit complicated, but what we do here is we think about lining up all the populations from lowest income to highest income. And so here's the 0th percentile, the person at the lowest point in the income distribution. And here's the person at the 100th percentile, at the highest point of the income distribution. And we're going to keep track of, as we add up the incomes of everyone up to that point, how much of total national income have we added up to. So let's say that by the time we add up to the 10th percentile, everyone in the 10th percentile or less, if we add up all of their income, we get to say 4% of overall national income. So we're going to build here what we call the Lorenz curve. And you can see, as we start going farther this way, we're going to get to a higher and higher level of national income. You know, for everyone 50th percent or below, maybe we have 30% of national income is being earned by everyone in the bottom half. And once we get to the 100th percentile, then by definition, all of national income must have been earned by someone in the 100th percentile or below. So we're going to have a curve that looks something like this. So that's the Lorenz curve. And then we figure out what the area of this gap is. And this gap gives us the difference between the Lorenz curve and what the Lorenz curve would be if we had a completely equal distribution of incomes. And you can see that, like, if incomes are more unequal, then this curve is going to be lower at the beginning and really rise quickly at the end, because we don't really start adding up much of national income until we get to these last couple of people here. So the bigger this area between this 45-degree line and the Lorenz curve, the higher the level of inequality. So what we can do here is we can take the area there and multiply it by 2. And what happens there is we've gotten what's called the Gini coefficient. And the Gini coefficient is going to be 0 if there's complete equality, just absolute, everyone has exactly the same income. And it's going to be 1 if we have complete inequality. Everyone has 0 income except for one person. Okay, so those are some of our measures of income inequality and how we look at that. The last thing to sort of think about here is sometimes we think that people might not mind inequality so much, or it might not be unfair if there's a high level of income mobility. And there's two different ways that people commonly measure income mobility. So one of the ways that people measure income mobility, and I'm going to make a simplified example here, is let's just imagine that we're going to look at the top half and the bottom half of the income distribution. And so over here, we're going to have people who start in the bottom half. So what half you started in, you're thinking about there, and where you ended up here. And if the world were completely random, this and this would both be 50-50. So if you started in the bottom half, you'd have a 50% chance of staying in the bottom half and a 50% chance of ending in the top half. Or if you started here, in the world were completely random, these two numbers would be 50-50. But we might say, for instance, see that this is 70% and this is 30% and this is 30% and this is 70%. So the closer those numbers are to 50-50 or a completely equal distribution, if we had more than two categories, sort of the more randomness there is. Mostly what people seem to care about, though, is they seem to measure income mobility as the bigger this number over here, then the bigger your chance of ending up in a higher income distribution bracket, given that you started in a low bracket. And I'll go ahead and put on the class website some data on this. When we look over relatively long periods, we actually get some surprisingly high numbers, and I'll let you guys look into that. The last way, actually, one last thing. This video segment's maybe getting a little bit long, but easier, I think, to put it in here, is intergenerational income mobility. So the previous way of looking at income mobility really keeps track typically of people's mobility over a 10, maybe 15, maybe 20-year time period. What sometimes happens with that is that in the bottom half of the distribution, we might say, for instance, pick up a bunch of people who are 20-year-olds, they have low income because they're going to college, say, but maybe they come from a family that's actually fairly well off. And so we sort of get the question of, are we really measuring what we most want to measure if we're sort of measuring people's natural transitions over the course of their life? Another way of looking at this is, how well does your parental economic status predict your economic status? And so what we often talk about here is what's called a coefficient of correlation for incomes across generations. And this gets a little bit complicated, but a common way that this might be studied would be something like, well, if your father's income, and usually because the role of women in the labor force has changed a lot over the generations, usually this is measured with fathers and sons to sort of, you know, make things as consistent as possible and not get sort of mixed up in the changing role of women. If your father's income was 20% higher than average for his generation, what is the most likely outcome for you? And you can see that what we're basically talking about here is how inheritable are income differences. And so we might say, for instance, come about here and see that we get a correlation coefficient of something like 0.5. And essentially what we'd be saying here is, if your father's income was 20% above average, then we would expect on average for you to have an income that's 10% above average. Because we expect some degree of what we call regression to the mean. That, you know, maybe your father was unusually lucky or something like that, and maybe the luck won't hold. Or, you know, if your father's income was 30% below average, then we expect some of that's due to bad luck that he encountered, and that maybe your income then is only likely to be 15% below average if we have this correlation coefficient. The higher this correlation coefficient, the more that income differences are heritable, the more that people who had parents that were low income are likely to be low income themselves, and the more that people who have parents that are high income are likely to have high income. And essentially, if we have a correlation coefficient of 0, there's no heritability of income. If we have a correlation coefficient of 1, there's no income mobility at all. Income is completely inheritable across generations.